God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item three, ceremonial items, and we don't have any tonight, so we'll move on to item four, the public forum. All right. Thank you very much. Lodell? Is that you, Lodell?
Antonio.
Antonio.
See that name?
I can't.
Yes. Okay, please come forward and state your name, please.
Nice to meet everyone. My name is Antonio Mims. I'm from San Francisco, California, 42 years old. I'm maintaining a 3.87 GPA, Bachelor of Science, General Psychology major. And I'm 63.5 credits deep. I'm at Colorado Technical University. I don't commute, though. It's online. I don't commute. It's online. There's a lot of gas. Thank you for having me. I'll definitely be speaking. The course that I'm in right now is group dynamics. So that generates a question within my head, directed not only just to the mayor. You know, I need to be able to communicate with others besides just the mayor. Okay, so my question is, do we have any current developments? The current developments or upcoming developments, will they, dare I say, appreciate the local economy? Like, are you here to leech off of us, or are you here to help the local economy out? Like, do we have any developments that's just obvious? Oh, they're here to help us. They're not here just for their own gain, you know? So that's what I wanted to bring up. Developers, they come through. You got the developer. You got the owner of the property. Has to find a developer. The developer is in charge of finding a contractor to contract the workout, you know? So we want to make sure that it's cohesiveness in this so we ain't getting jerked, basically. You know, you got people that are coming to your town and just stomp on your block, and we don't want that to happen. We want to make sure that they're here to help, not just here to leech. On that note,
I thank you for your time tonight, and now the council has the questions, so they'll be ready for you. All right. Did we have a second?
Yeah, Bruce.
Bruce Manwaring, did you have a comment tonight?
Just to thank the Highway Patrol for canceling the ticket.
All right. Thank you. That'll be the end of our public forum. We'll move on to item five, consent and approval of agenda. Item A is approval of minutes of the August 26, 2024 regular council meeting. Item B is the approval of minutes of the August 26, 2024 work session. Item C is the approval of minutes of the August 22, 2024 special council meeting. Item D is license and permits. Item E is a resolution declaring Mexican Independence Day celebration as a community festival, September 15, 2024. Item F is a resolution accepting Toward Zero Death TZD Enforcement Grant Award, Minnesota Department of Public Safety. And item G is a resolution declaring Hometown Pride Fall Cleanup Day and authorizing reduced rates at the transfer station. Council?
Move to approve the consent and approval of agenda, Your Honor.
Okay, motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Anderson. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item six is petitions, requests, and communications, and we do not have any tonight. We'll move on to item seven, unfinished business. Under item 7A, ordinance 24-127, amending chapter 50, zoning on cannabis, off-sale liquor, tobacco, and sexually orientated businesses. Second reading. City manager?
Thank you, Your Honor.
Let me get my place here real quick, and then I will ask Wayne Sorensen, our zoning official, to come up and speak to the speak a little bit more about this and try to answer any questions that the council may have. I know that there were some from the last meeting. But this is the final reading of an ordinance amending Chapter 50 to add zoning related to cannabis, off-sale liquor, tobacco, and sexually oriented business. This ordinance inserts the 13 Minnesota defined cannabis businesses into appropriate City of Albert Lea zoning districts. Sections were added to address setbacks from entities that are typically oriented towards minors and families. These include schools, daycares, treatment facilities, parks, athletic fields, and also buildings used for religious worship or gatherings. A section was added to regulate design standards, much like existing community business districts, B2 standards. A section was added to address and enforce standards regarding odor control of cannabis facilities. Where appropriate, liquor stores, tobacco stores, and sexually oriented businesses were like regulated. Staff recommends approval of this final reading. With that, I would like to present Wayne Sorensen, our zoning inspector, to try and answer any questions, not any questions, but questions related to this ordinance and zoning, zoning in general. We're not gonna play Jeopardy here, but we hope we'll be able to answer any questions that the council may have.
No.
I do have a question.
Councilman Baker.
There was a gentleman here last meeting that was concerned about the place that he plans if he gets accepted as far as licensing and all that. I think he said his place was maybe 2 or 3 feet within the 500-foot limit. I think he said, if I remember right, I don't remember if it was a park or if it was a childcare.
It was a daycare center.
Daycare, okay. Is that, I mean, are you gonna take that in consideration? That's, you know.
So if I can answer, the ordinance as it reads has a 500-foot setback from park, daycare, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way it would be in the ordinance then. If it's 499 feet away, I would not have the authority to say, close enough, you can do it. It's not my decision. It is something that falls within distances, height, all that is something that you can, well, you can apply for variance for anything, but it's actually something that's commonly asked for, and you could ask for a variance on it. You do have to prove a practical difficulty.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a whole nother ordinance that we've had in the books forever, and it's also mm-hmm. backed up by state statutes. So that's all I can say there. The ordinance as it reads, 499 isn't good enough for me to be able to approve it.
Okay, so as it sits now, he would not be able to open it.
Correct.
Has anybody from the city talked to him about this? I remember somebody saying that they were, I think it was you that said we're looking at
it. City manager?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. I believe that at the meeting, he already knows that he would have to seek a variance
okay.
for this. So I think that that's already pretty well known by the individual. Whether or not it meets the definition of doing so is a determination later, because we could never say that someone can't, you know, apply for a variance in advance. They have every right to do that. But there are certain requirements that then they have to meet. I'd also like to just remind everyone, though, that when people talk about this, they talk about making millions of dollars a year. So a matter of, I can't find another building, alter the property, et cetera. When we're talking, I'm sorry, did I say a billion? I'm going to make $1 million a year, millions of dollars in payroll and all that. The idea that somehow they just have to go into a building without any corrections or property or find a property that would fit when they have such plans, I think is just the idea of bending the code to meet that just also seems to be kind of out of place, because you know, financial considerations are often not considered a practical or a practical difficulty, I believe is what it's called.
Financial considerations alone cannot be a...
Yeah, that alone cannot be it. So we've got... So, I mean, we do have to make a determination of how many feet. Mm-hmm. And I think overall the general response has been take it to what the state has, you know, created limits on. So we have taken it to the state maximum allowed distance.
So,
and also applied this to other businesses as well in this.
So Mr. Meinhardt knows that he would have to take it to the Board of Appeals and that the final decision, you know, what they came up with would be the final decision. The only other thing he would have to go ahead.
The Board of Appeals recommendation does come to the council.
Right, okay.
Yeah. For the final determination.
Yep, yeah. Okay. But he understands all that. I just want to make sure that he's been told.
I believe from what he even stated at the meeting, he's already aware of the process, but if he has not been, then we'll make sure that staff does let him know what the process is. But I understand it as he does currently know, but we will double check to make sure that he is aware of that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, additional questions?
Your Honor.
Councilor Howland.
Just following up on that topic, when it comes to setbacks and the 500 feet, in particular for, I guess, the only one that would probably apply would be daycares. If a business opens up and is in compliance in regards to the 500 feet, but then let's say a daycare business opens up next door, they're still in compliance, right? Are they grandfathered in, or how does that work?
So statute actually addressed the idea of a setback for the cannabis specifically. If a daycare or a park or something opens up or moves into that circle, uh-huh, we can no way restrict anything to do with the original business that was there. So they're not; it's not only grandfathered; they have full rights.
And what if the business changes owners?
Doesn't matter.
Yeah,
it's still got full rights.
Okay, thanks,
Your Honor.
Councilor Anderson.
Yeah, I'm going to be supporting this measure, but I'm doing so with the understanding that this council and future councils will be we'll look at each individual situation. It's kind of a breathing variance. The 499 feet. I think it would be nice to think that if decisions need to be made in the future, that whether this council or future councils.
If I might comment, I think the original or the problem that's being discussed tonight would be an original problem when the ordinance first passes. When the ordinance is in place and somebody new comes into town 2 years from now, I would hope they'd be looking specifically for something outside the 500 feet and not, have the same issue that's going to happen in this first round. I just think it'll become a lesser of an issue as it goes forward, if that makes sense.
Okay. Anybody else? All right. Thank you, Wayne.
Thank you.
So, anyone would like to make a motion?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Christensen. Any further discussion? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Olson?
Aye.
Councilor Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item B is a resolution approving publication summary of Ordinance 24-127. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Summaries may be published if they reasonably inform the public of the effect and the intent of the ordinance. Summaries fulfill all legal requirements as if the entire summarized matter has been published and also directs the public how to obtain the complete ordinance. Staff recommends approval to publish an ordinance summary for Ordinance 24-127.
Council?
Move to approve.
Motion by Councilor Christensen. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Howland. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 8, new business. A is a resolution adopting the 2025 preliminary budget and property tax levy. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. This resolution adopts the budget or the preliminary levy. Levy is a 15.75 increase over the 2024 final tax levy. Approximately 10 of the 15.75% is attributed to the referendum approved improvements to recreation. The preliminary property tax levy of $8,903,000 can be reduced before final adoption in December, but not increased. Finance Director Christy Brutlag will have a presentation on the preliminary budget, the preliminary general fund budget and the general fund and debt tax levy. Staff recommends approval.
Mayor and Council, I'm going to go over the 2025 preliminary general fund budget and the property tax levy for 2025. So the revenues for 2025, we're looking at an increase from 19.8 million up to about 20.3 million, which is a change of about 481,000. The expenses, 19 million again, preliminary budget of 20.76 for a total increase of 864. And as you can see on there, there's a difference of the 383. So the 383 is always made up by an increase in the tax levy. So that's what we're looking for as a general fund tax levy for 2025. Just kind of a little bit of historical data. In 2022, we were about 1.9% higher than 21. 2023, we were about 5.3% higher. And then last year, we were about 9.8% higher than 2023. And this year, we're looking at an increase of about 4.3% over the 2024 budget. So I think we talk about general fund and any revenue for the city kind of stays a little bit steady. There have been a few changes. Again, there's the $383,000 increase in the levy. We're looking some other increases that are notable. We're looking at some increases in the in the charges for services. There's an increase in for cannabis sales tax, about $50,000. There is a grant in the intergovernmental, about $28,000 for a new building inspector position that we're looking at. And then police state aid, $82,000 increase. And we talked a lot earlier tonight about mowing and garbage cleanup. We're looking at an increase revenue and charges for services there, about $20,000. And those revenues are always offset with some those expenses in that department. Other than that, the bigger increases are the transfers from the utility funds for overhead, about $198,000, for a total increase of revenue about $864,000. A lot of these graphics you're going to see tonight are going to show up on our social media, and you might see them other places. So our 2025 general fund budget, where does the money come from? We are 33% general government aid. That's our local government aid. That's where we do get our revenue from. 29% is city property taxes, 16% charges for services, 12% are those transfers in from the utility funds to cover overhead. And mostly what we're talking about there is transfers to cover expenses for like finance or engineering. Those water and sewer budgets don't have any expenses in there for those departments. And then about 10% increase from franchise fees from gas, electricity, and cable television. The 2025 general fund expense budget, the largest increase in the 2025 budget is in personnel services. That includes anything that we pay and these are only including our general fund employees. So it does include everything. It includes para, health insurance, FICA, Medicare, any costs that have to do with those employees. And from 2024 to 2025, we're looking at about $1.1 million increase, about 7.48%. The rest of the categories, the supplies, other services and charges stayed pretty steady. And then the overall transfers. So we do some transfers into our utility funds and into our some capital project funds to fund some different purchases. And we're kind of staying the same as 2024. The only change is that we're going to put an additional $60,000 into the Broadway Ridge Grant Fund. And then we're going to remove for 2025, transfer into the building maintenance fund. After kind of getting in the capital projects for the building maintenance fund, we felt that a decrease in that transfer for this year would be okay for 2025. And again, we'll look at that next year to see where that fund is at. So we're looking at a total increase of $864,000, or about 4.35%. And we always look at where does our money go. We're a pretty typical city. 43% of our general fund budget is for public safety, which is police, fire, and our inspections department. Also includes our community service department that we were that does all our refuse cleanup. Culture and recreation would be anything from the library to the arena to our parks, any recreational activities that we have going on. Public works is 16%, and that would be engineering and any street maintenance. 14% general government, and that's anything from finance to the council to the city manager budget, city clerk budget, those types of departments. And then 7% from transfers, fund transfers for equipment. We do transfer out into the capital project funds, as we showed earlier on this slide. 7% of our budget is for those expenses, for those transfers. So now we're down, kind of down to the levy. So again, we're looking at a $383,000 increase, which is about, and we're kind of going to stay with a column on the far right. We're going to look at the 25% increase over the total from 2024. For 2025, we're looking at a general fund levy increase of about 4.98%. The debts from 2010 to 2023, there's a decrease about 2%. The new debt issues from 2024 for the street projects, about 2.57%. The arena solar project, about 0.6%. And then the recreational facilities project, which is a 21-year levy, is the 9.6% for a total debt levy increase of 10.77, and then a total general fund and debt levy increase of 15.75%, or about $1.2 million. So how does that affect the tax rate? So this is the information that we received from the county talking about tax capacity. The tax capacity for 2025 increased about $376,000. About 2.64%. And you can see on there, you know, the largest increase was for all other commercial and industrial properties. But again, this is net tax capacity, which helps us to calculate the tax rate. So again, our tax rate, tax capacity for 2025 is $14.6 million. So how does that affect the tax rate? For 2025, if you look at the 2025 requested column, you can take the tax levy of $8.9 million divided by the tax capacity, about $14.6 million, and then gives us a tax rate of 60.926, which is an increase from 2024 of 12.77%. How does that affect a $100,000 home? In 2025, a $100,000 home will have taxes of, and remember, it's just city taxes. It doesn't count the city or the county, the HRA, or the school district. That $100,000 property, the taxes on that property would be $609.26, which is an increase from 2024 of $69.01, and a per month increase of about $5.75. In prior years, we've talked about how the tax capacity goes up, and in 2023, if you remember, the tax capacity went way up. We've had some smaller increases in the last couple of years, but if your $100,000 home did go up, with the tax capacity would go up, have gone up, your taxes for 2025 would be $625.35, increase of about $85.10, and per month of $7.09. So, I mean, the tax rate is what we're always looking at, and so the percent, the tax rate percent increase for 2025 is 12.77%. Just to kind of highlight for more information, what impact did the rec facilities project have on the tax levy? a per-year amount of that $609.26 we talked about earlier. $50.50 of it is for the rec facilities project. $1,809 is for general fund, and $140.67 is for other projects. And you can see those increases as you look across. But again, just trying to show you what the impact of the rec facilities project, and it was an increase in the tax rate on a six. If you're looking at the 609.26 tax increase, $50.50 is from the rec facility project. And we always talk about, you know, so I'm paying this $609.26 per year. What am I getting for that? And $60 is from general government, again, administration, finance, human resources, city attorney, and community engagement. $178.11 is from public safety, again, police, fire, and building inspection. $67.73 for public works, which is streets, engineering, stormwater, and then $84.87 on culture and recreation, which is parks, forestry, recreation, and library. $26.76 for transfers out. Again, $50.50 for the rec facilities project, and $140.67 for debt service. And those debt service are mostly on street projects. This is another graphic you'll be seeing the next couple of weeks. What do your city taxes provide? And again, this is taking those numbers from the prior slide and then taking it into a per month basis. So $1,484 a month for public safety, $707 for culture and recreation, and so on. So again, the rec facilities project is $4.21 a month, and then the debt service for other street projects is $11.72. And then tonight we're gonna approve a resolution for the 2025 HRA levy. The HRA is requesting the maximum amount they can request, which is determined by state statute. It has to be 0.0185 of the 2025 estimated market value. So the maximum the HRA levy can be is $266,000. They're requesting $265,000 to put towards the Shady Oaks facade project that they're working on right now.
Councilor Anderson. No, Baker, excuse me.
The HRA levy and any of these other ones, but HRA in particular, change both the amount and the project if they decide they want to allocate that out differently for different projects. When we approve in December, just like our preliminary levy can lower, theirs can lower as well. Can't go higher. Ours can't go higher.
Go ahead.
One thing I'd want to say is with the HRA, instead of hiring, you know, increasing it 15, we might as well go with the 16. So it would be.
Are you saying they wanted the maximum of $266,116?
Well, just go to $16.
$266,000.
Right.
We'll I did talk there, to.
And then we'll have. At our next board meeting, we'll have a discussion on if we want to keep it there or if we want to lower it. This way, we have the whole thing, what we can possibly get, and what the expenses that we have. I'd like to hear what Councilor Anderson would like.
Well, if you make Councilor the motion, Anderson. I'll support it, Your Honor.
Okay. All right. Well, I just wanted to bring that up.
When I walk through these with the HRA director.
Christy, could I hold you for a second? City manager?
Oh, I was going to say, Your Honor, I believe Christy has something.
When we did talk to her, so we were at 265, I'm sure. I mean, going to 266 will be just fine. So the resolution has 265 in it.
I have an additional question on that one, Your Honor.
Councilor Holland.
On the facade. Didn't we allocate pre-2024, weren't they always asking the maximum for the facade? like 2023, wasn't it, for the facade, and maybe 2022?
In 2023, I know they did ask for the maximum again, but I think it was just general building repairs that they needed to. I'm not exactly sure if it was specifically.
So this is the first time for the facade?
Facade. Specifically for this facade, this is the first year that I remember. I mean, some of that money from 2023 could have went toward, because it was more, they just needed some money for some building repairs.
Because they've been working on that.
Mm-hmm. For several years, yes. Yep. I think between now and when we adopt final in December, their board is going to be meeting and determining for sure if they need the full 265 or 266 now, and then if they want to keep it at the Shady Oaks facade project. So those can be changed before we adopt in December. Okay. So just some next steps. Tonight we're going to adopt the preliminary levy and the general fund budget. October and November we'll finalize the general fund budget. And we're, you know, we did go through a first draft of the 25 to 29 capital improvement plan. We'll be finalizing that, making some adjustments, reviewing the water, sewer, and senior center and airport budgets with the council budget committee, and then update the financial management plan. And then we also are going to review the fee schedule as well, including the water and sewer rates. And then on December 9th, we'll approve the budgets, the final budgets, final HRA levy, final city levy, approve the 2025 to 2029 capital improvement plan, and then adopt the 2025 fee schedule, including the water and the sewer rates. So tonight we're just talking about general fund.
And so I'm assuming once we set this, we're going to be looking to see if we can further reduce that.
Absolutely. So we'll spend the fall. You know, I mean, I think as you can, you know, understand, it's August. You know, we kind of have numbers through the end of August. And, you know, it's early September now. So, you know, as we get some more history in, we might look at some line items and find out that we're way over budget. I think our departments did a great job this year with their budgets, but that doesn't mean that we won't be looking at them in the next couple months. And I mean, always through these next couple months, Ian's looking at them. And, you know, we're always careful not to make, you know, small adjustments here, small adjustments there, but really looking for stuff that needs to be adjusted, because if you're going to adjust a little up on this line, you need to make sure you're looking at the other ones down. So I think we'll be doing a lot of looking at the budget in the next few months to make sure that we're where we should be.
Any additional questions for the city finance director?
Your Honor.
Councilman Anderson.
Christy, this is, I got a couple of questions actually. First, I was just thinking that other than the new labor contract that helped bring our pay more in line with rest of the cities, and the referendum, did anything else really go up? I mean, are those the only two things,
you know,
impacting
the
budget?
I mean, that is really the story this year, is the personnel expenses, the adopting the, you know, the
and that's
plan
not just
and
information
then,
for the council. I think that's
yep.
information that the
yep.
public needs to understand too. Pretty much
yeah,
nothing else
I,
went
I,
up.
I
is
mean,
that
if
what
you
I'm
look
seeing?
At our expense budget, I think our you can see that our really in total, I mean, if you take the 27,000 and the 141, we were pretty level from 2024. Yeah. So if we wouldn't have had that, implementing that study, which was a good thing for the city, you know, we would be, it'd be a little bit different picture.
And but we're obviously seeing the benefits of that already, because the police department is like near full staff. And
I'm going to let Ian comment on that, because I don't have direct sure. first hand knowledge of that. I mean, I do, but yeah. I feel like that's more of an Ian question.
Other questions?
Well, Your Honor,
City Manager,
I believe you're asking about some of the other expenses and also related to the personnel. I would say that we have seen some improvements in certain areas with the number and the quality of candidates, and not having losing people to certain jobs nearby, whether it's private sector or other public sector entities. We've seen less of that. We've been experiencing less than that than what we were in maybe 2023, I believe, or 2024, somewhere around there. So while we were experiencing that, it seems to have come down a little bit. So I do believe that there have been some definite benefits to that. And then personnel is a huge factor, but we are going to continue to monitor things like we will monitor the outcomes of temporary staff, you know, like seasonal staff, like what the outcomes were there as we've had to take on mowing more properties, as we've acquired more properties through demolition, and other things as well. So we'll be, again, we'll be going through that and the during, after our third quarter's kind of somewhat in the books as much as it can be.
We are, again, we've always talked about this, we're 70, over probably 72% personnel expenses of our general fund budget. And I know that that's pretty typical for a city unless they've got other things going through their budgets. But
I think that's an important point to make, not just to the council, but, you know, we kind of know that from our meetings, but to the public. The other thing, when people hear that number, the 15%, it's not like their property tax is going up 15%. The city's portion of that property tax is what portion of somebody's city property tax bill is actually the city's?
Correct. I mean, there is the county's portion and the school district's portion, and then again, the HRA portion as well. Those are all parts of this total, of your total tax bill. It's not just the city's taxes, correct?
Do we know approximately what that percentage is? What's the city's percentage of that?
I don't know off the top of my head.
I'm thinking about 40, isn't it?
I have typically gone 40, 40, 20, 40 city, 40 county, 20 school, but I'm not saying that that's accurate every year, but I think as just a very, very rough division,
I think if we,
rounding.
Yeah, and I think to have that, and that's a good thing. We'll bring that to the, when we adopt and final, you know, until they have their final numbers, until we know exactly where they're at, it's a little bit harder to say exactly how that breaks out.
Well, as somebody that's new to the budget committee, I see how detailed this process is and how much work goes in it. And it's kind of amazing that nothing really got added to the budget except the things that was voted on in an election and, of course, the new labor contracts, which were very important and necessary. So,
correct.
It's good. Yeah,
we had a really great budget session. I think our budgets look really great, and there's a lot of good information in there, and it's accurate. So,
Councilor Baker. Councilor Holland.
I just wanted to clarify one thing on that Councilor Anderson said when he said that our pay raises. I just want to clarify, so the people at the pub, you know, out there in the viewing land that are watching this, our raises is not the city council. The city council has not had a raise. Unlike some of our other government officials at the county and state level, we have not given ourselves a raise in since my time on the council. It's probably been over 20 years. So city councilors are not getting a big pay raise with this tax levy.
They are not. And any raise in the council salaries has to be approved by resolution. So it's a whole separate process. But you are correct.
So he's speaking about, when he says our pay raises, he's talking about the city as a whole, but the city council is not getting a pay raise.
Thank you for the clarification.
You're welcome.
I was just wondering if anybody on the city staff has heard any rumblings or anything about what the school board and county are going to be doing for their levy, just to kind of get an idea.
City manager, have you heard anything?
What I've heard to date is that it's going to be more than the years past because they're hit with expenses. What the final outcome is going to be and how they get there, I'm not certain. But I know that everyone has been faced with certain difficulties. I think we probably head off some of our difficulties last year, and we're just more on schedule between the referendum and what we had already kind of set in motion the year before. But I've heard that they are facing some very difficult decisions, and there will be likely increases, but what the final outcome is, I have a hard time venturing a guess at this point. We're just gonna have to wait to see what their preliminary adoption is going to be in the next few weeks.
I think the one thing you have to keep in mind, too, is we are early. I mean, we usually don't adopt our budget and levy till our second meetings, and we're adopting it on the first, which is great. But sometimes some of those, like, what are the other cities doing, information, counties, school district, we're early. We're early, which is great. But kind of limits that information.
Counselor Baker, did you have one wrap-up question?
Well, I was just going to say, I just have a comment. No matter how you look at it, no matter how you slice it this year, it's going to be a big hit for everybody, you know, and especially the people in the city, because they're paying all three of the taxes. So I will say that, being that I was on the budget committee, tax committee, and I'll repeat what Counselor Anderson says. Staff has gone through this with a better than a fine-tuned comb, the way I look at it. They're looking at everything, and hopefully, by the time it comes to actually approve this, they'll find some more. I guess that's the task I put before you.
All right, Counselor Christensen.
Thank you. And I kind of echo that we're not done looking at that number. But I wanted to thank our finance director, all the department heads, for doing a great job of getting us here. I especially want to thank the city manager and the other counselors for attending a special session to review all this information so we can be far better prepared to discuss this and really understand what's going into it.
I'd agree. We've had some great meetings and a lot of good information, and our department heads do great. I mean, I end up with the easy part at the end, but not the easy part, but it all comes down to the detail, and I'm confident in the detail, and I'm confident of the people that are putting the detail together.
All right. Thank you for your presentation. Appreciate it. Would entertain a motion.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Counselor Anderson. Is there a second?
I'll second that, Your Honor.
Second by Counselor Rasmussen. Any further discussion? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor Olson?
Aye.
Counselor Rasmussen?
Aye.
Counselor Anderson?
Aye.
Counselor Christensen?
Aye.
Counselor Baker?
Aye.
Counselor Holland?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item B is a resolution approving the HRA preliminary property tax levy for fiscal year 2025. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. This resolution adopts the 2025 HRA preliminary levy of $265,000, but I would ask that during the motion, someone amend it to $266,000 in their motion. Minnesota State Statute 469.033, Subdivision 6, limits the HR levy to 0.0185% of the estimated market value for the 2025 year. The maximum amount is $266,000 and $266,116, excuse me. The levy is an increase of will be an increase of $16,000, or a little over 5.67% increase over the 2024 final HRA tax levy. The HRA is requesting these funds to be designated for the building facade project. This levy can be reduced but not increased before final adoption in December. The designation of the funds can be changed before final adoption in December. The HRA board requests approval. Staff recommends approval.
Counsel?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Counselor Baker.
Excuse
me. I move to approve it in the amount of $266,000. Increased by $1,000.
Second by Counselor Anderson. Any further discussion?
Yeah, and I just wanted to say,
Counselor Baker,
that I, being on the HRA board, I took the liberty to do this, being it as a preliminary tax rate. One thing is, with that facade project out there, once they got the old facade off, they ran into a lot of different issues, and it's going to cost a lot more money. So we're going to need all the money that we can get to be able to complete that project. I know that Dr. Mitchell is working with the state in trying to secure some more money, and it looks pretty promising. So that's the reason I did that. And we'll have our board meeting 2 weeks from tomorrow, and then we'll decide on if we want to go with that, or if we want to lower it, or how we want to do it. That's all I have to say, Your Honor. Thank you.
Any additional discussion?
Your Honor.
Counselor Anderson.
This might be a question best saved for an HRA meeting, but I think Ian can answer it. Does the HRA locally always ask for the state max, or have they historically asked for less than that?
City Manager?
I believe up until maybe 2-3 years ago, it was never to the max. I think that the project that's currently underway has been a big driver for increasing the cost to rehab buildings, materials, all of that, I think has been a big driver for
the increase.
I
appreciate you confirming that, because I think that's the point I was trying to make, that they usually didn't get all the money, but now they're doing so because they have this.
I believe so. I know that Councilor Baker and Councilor Olson have been involved for many years with the HRA.
It's been the last 2 or 3 years, yes.
Yeah.
Prior to that, it was a smaller amount. All right. Any additional discussion? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Yes.
Councilor Olson?
Aye.
Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item C is a resolution authorizing Broadway Ridge Grant Agreement with Linda Knutson, 129 Broadway Avenue South. City Manager?
Thank you. The applicant submitted an application for reimbursement at 50% of the costs associated with brick repair. The total improvement cost is $1,100. Excuse me. Which provides for a grant match per our policy of $550. All improvements have been completed and reviewed by the city zoning and building official for compliance with application requirements. Staff recommends the approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Who was the second one?
I'll second.
Councilor Anderson with a second. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item D is a resolution approving policies for cell phone use, vehicle use, tuition, and public purpose. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Human Resources and City staff are requesting the City Council to approve the following amended, new, and expanded handbook provisions. The purpose of these policies is continued employee development, recruitment, and retention. These changes establish a uniform and equitable system of personnel administration for all employees. Staff recommends approval of the following. Policy 7.02, cell phone policy. This policy has been revised to eliminate the two-tier reimbursement allowance system and make it in one amount. The policy intends to define acceptable and unacceptable uses of city-issued cellular phones. It is applicable, its application is to ensure cell phone usage is consistent with the best interests of the city without unnecessary restrictions of employees and conduct of their duties. Policy 7.35, vehicle use. The purpose of this policy is to establish guidelines for the proper and safe use of city-owned vehicles for the benefits of its citizens. Policy 7.36, public purpose expenditure. The purpose of this policy is to provide guidance and assistance to staff on what type of expenses may be appropriate expenditures of public funds. Policy 7.38, tuition reimbursement. The purpose of this policy is to assist employees in upgrading their job skills and knowledge by taking courses from an accredited institution. I made a typo. And staff recommends approval.
All right.
Thank you.
Council?
Move to approve without the typo.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Christensen. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item E is a resolution authorizing action on tax forfeited properties. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Staff have reviewed the 8 properties in Albert Lea that are under tax forfeiture. The process is different than in prior years, as the city has to wait 2 bidding cycles before it can request a property from the county for a dollar, as we've done in the past. Staff are recommending either full or partial amounts of city assessments to remain during the 2 bidding processes. Those lowered in total assessment are properties that pose little concern in zoning, blight, or future loss to the tax base. They also pose little interest for future municipal utilities or infrastructure. Given the value of the property is limited, staff recommends a reduction to encourage private development. Other properties may pose concern, and while the city certainly would not oppose private ownership, if those concerns occur at if those concerns occur at minimum for the public, they will see at the public will at least see full reimbursement for those assessments. Two properties are going through condemnation process due to poor condition. Staff recommends approval. And I would ask that someone amend the resolution to say that the 720 Minnesota property be lowered to $5,000 in retained assessment.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor, with the lowering the 720 Minnesota Avenue.
To $5,000?
$5,000.
Thank you.
Is there a second?
I'll second that, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Olson. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item F is a resolution authorizing settlement and release agreement with Trails Travel Plaza, Inc. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. The city is settling with Trails Travel Plaza. They challenged the assessments for job 2103, paving of 209th and resurfacing of Happy Trails Lane. To prevent further consultant and legal fees, basically fees that staff were not certain would be reimbursed, we recommend the settlement that pays 100% of the original assessment. The city position that the assessments were fair and accurate under state statute is preserved. Additional resolutions will be needed to remove the original assessment so Trails Travel Plaza can pay in full the remaining portion of the assessment per the settlement. Staff recommends approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
Second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Baker. Any further discussion? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Holland?
Yes.
Councilor Olson?
Aye.
Councilor Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item 9 is mayor and council reports, and tonight we'll start with Councilor Holland.
Oh, geez.
Ward 3.
I knew you were going to do that to me. Honestly, I don't have a whole lot, Mr. Mayor. Park and Rec Board did not meet last month. I was not at the last city council meeting, so I'm not sure what all since a month has transpired, what all I gave for information last time. But I will say that congratulations to the Albert Lee Anglers. They had a team compete in, they had two teams compete in the high school state bass fishing tournament over in Wabasha, Minnesota this weekend. And one of the Albert Lee teams finished fifth place in the state and has likely qualified for the Bassmasters High School National Championships next year. So, and I happened to be the boat captain for that team. So I drove those two kids around and they caught some big fish. So congratulations to the Anglers. It's a great organization, gets youth out fishing out in the outdoors. So it's great. No ward issues, no ward items. And like I said, Park and Rec Board meeting was canceled. So I have nothing else, Your Honor. Thank you.
All right. Ward 2, Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Your Honor. You'll have to excuse my voice. I have allergies this time of year, and I've been doing today, been doing a lot of talking.
That's hard to believe.
I am. Last week we had a LEDA meeting, being that we had some people on vacation and some people missing. I had to work, so I wasn't able to attend the meeting. So the mayor will have to fill that part of it in. I talked to city manager, and he's working on a couple word items for me. And I do have we're having a housing meeting with the county and the HRA tomorrow afternoon from 11 to 1, and I will be in attendance. So I will let you know what happens there. Basically, this is just a meeting to get the entities together to see what we can do to increase our housing.
stock, and also, you know, who's responsible to do what and how we can work together, and that's what this meeting's all about. So, with that, Your Honor, that'll do it.
All right, thank you. Ward 1, Councilor Christensen.
Thank you, Your Honor. Several items for the ward. Several people have reached out to say the deer population, particularly that comes through the Bancroft Bay Park area, are very destructive to the landscaping, to the community garden areas and such, and they are hoping for some form of relief. So it's probably time to consider some sort of a hunt. The herd has gotten quite thick. The other thing that has come up several times from constituents is concern about safety on the trails, and that would be from either like motorized, like the e-bikes going too fast, or scooter use. And I have spoken with Kathy Malachowski about that. She will be bringing that to the trail committee to be looking at recommendations for education regarding safety use, sharing the trail, trail speed, and general etiquette that applies as we all use our beautiful trails. Speaking of which, I was on the extension out to the state park on Sunday. It is so beautiful. If you haven't had a chance to be out, take that time in these gorgeous fall days to explore. It's a great resource. The Budget Committee will continue to be meeting. The Blue Zones Committee has met and has some wonderful programs that are going to be rolling out. Particularly, we're starting to focus on what can we provide in January through community ed and such. And there's so many talented people working on those committees. Also, the worksite program to encourage healthy habits and become a Blue Zone certified worksite. We are looking for more businesses to join that. If you have a business or would like to recommend the place you work, reach out to us. We're always happy to talk about how that can impact your workplace, increasing your satisfaction and your health and longevity. And then finally, I just want to say a shout out to the Planning and Zoning Commission. They did a lot of work on the adult-oriented businesses that we approved tonight. Those commissioners attended special meetings and really did a lot of work. So in addition to the city staff, I want to thank those commissioners. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Let's see. Ward 6, Councilor Anderson.
Your Honor. Both budget and HRA have been pretty busy lately. Got more meetings coming up. I know we'll get back to it after this preliminary is passed now. I attended an event uptown, not in my ward, but I did see the mayor across the parking lot at Hope Church yesterday. And I didn't see you in the dunk tank, however. Therefore, I did not line up to throw the balls in the dunk tank, but I seen that there was quite an event going on.
He got out of another one, didn't he?
Got out of another one. I got a couple ward items that I'm working on, but that's about it.
All right. Ward 5, Councilor Rasmussen.
Yeah, Your Honor. I have an airport board meeting to attend next week, and I have no ward items currently.
All right. Thank you. Ward 4, Councilor Olson.
Yes, I had one ward item dealing with the mailbox on our construction project. I was copied on the email, so hopefully staff got back to him with an answer. Also, kind of went on a walk through the neighborhood where we did a couple of the road projects, was able to talk with a couple residents, asked them how the whole process went. They were both happy with it. Said it took a little longer than they thought, but kind of that's how it goes. They were happy with the finished product. So that's it, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. So for the past couple weeks, I've had a couple ALETA update meetings, and also we had our ALETA board meeting this past week. There are a number of projects that we're moving on, and in all different sectors, whether that be different retail items, stores, housing. We've got several housing projects that we're working on, trying to bring to fruition here over the next 12 to 18 months. And so a lot of good things going on there. I attended the Daisy Fest on Saturday, and that looked to be very well attended. It was busy, and so a lot of people there, and people from all over. I mean, it was a lot of people from out of town were at that. So that was good to see, a very nice day to be out doing that. Attended one of the Thursdays on Fountain, and as Councilor Anderson mentioned, we were at the Hope Church 10th anniversary of the Hope Church being downtown in Albert Lea from their opening. It's hard to believe that's already been 10 years. And then I attended a couple more parties that evening, or Saturday evening, the 112 celebrating their 10th anniversary and Bleachers celebrating their 5th anniversary. They had a little block party down on South Broadway, so that was kind of fun. There was at least a couple hundred people there when I was there, and looked to be well attended, and thank them for feeding us and giving us places to hang out for the last 5 and 10 years, and we look forward to continuing to go into those fine establishments. So just a reminder, fall sports and activities are in full swing right now. And so go out and enjoy watching our young people. Lots of high school activities, whether that be band and choir, football, soccer, cross country, there's all sorts of things going on. So get out there, take part in it. We've got a great group of young people out there working hard, and they'll give you some good entertainment. I attended a couple football games last week, attended a couple cross country meets, and look forward to many, many more. And we'll get out to some soccer and some other activities going on. But I encourage everybody else to get out and do that also. Let's get behind our sports teams and our different activities within the community and really show the high school and the students and families here that we really support them. And then calendar of events, things that are coming up. So Saturday, September 14th, the Albert Lea Family YMCA at 2021 West Main is celebrating their 110th year anniversary from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. with an old-fashioned patio party. Non-members will be able to go to the YMCA for free that day. Come on out, celebrate the history of the YMCA. And then also on Saturday the 14th, St. John's Lutheran Community will have a 5K event from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. The 5K race will start and end at the Fountain Lake campus at 1861 Eagle View Circle. Drivers in this area, please watch for slow signs where the runners will be traveling. If any of the counselors are interested in partaking in this, I would sponsor you. So keep that in mind. Let me know. It'd be good to get some help out there for this event. And then Tuesday, September 17th from 4 to 6 p.m., the Albert Lea Recreation in partnership with Police and Fire will host a Safety Day event at Morin Park, 222 St. Mary Avenue. This is a community building event where residents can learn about the services provided throughout the community. There will be demonstrations and informational booths set up for the police, fire, and other local agencies, and there will also be food trucks there. In addition, Saturday, September 21st, we have the Albert Lea Austin Walk to End Alzheimer's event, which will be at Frank Hall Park, 712 Frank Avenue. Registration is at 9 a.m., the ceremony at 10 a.m., and the walk starting at 10:20. The Walk to End Alzheimer's event throughout the country is the largest fundraiser for the care and support and research. There currently are 23 teams registered for this event at Frank Hall Park. And then also Saturday, September 21st, Recovery for Life event will be held from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at Central Park, 300 West Clark Street. This event focuses on individuals struggling with addiction and mental health issues. This event is for everyone. There will be speakers sharing their message of hope, informational booths from support organizations, games for kids, adults, and food trucks. And that's the list of the activities coming up. I'm sure there's many, many more, but go on out to the city website and you can see some of those that are going on. With that, we'll move along to the city manager report. City manager?
All right, thank you, Your Honor. Councilmember Olson had reminded me of something, and that is asking people satisfaction about how a construction project went. Always goes better after it's done than while it's currently going on. Yeah, it's always best to ask after the fact. But also, just so the council members know, we did throw in a bit in the resolution about the council members having to volunteer on the cleanup day. So, but in all seriousness, I do want to thank everyone that has helped out, staff, elected officials, everyone, members of the community, when we have gone through this moratorium, and we still have a little bit more to go because we have to deal with the business licensing. So we're not quite done yet, but we've got the zoning portion done. Now we'll be dealing with the business licensing, so that will be coming up shortly. And when it comes to the budget, as we've said before, a lot of work done. I'm very proud of how early we've gotten it done, how much work has been put into it, how well the process went this year. And but we'll still continue to work on that. And same with code enforcement. As you can see, that we have seen a major step up in the inspections and the work that has been done using contracted services, getting actual results for the people. It may not be 100%. It's going to be very difficult to get to 100%, especially getting 100% where people self-comply. We're working on that. We have more to go, but I want to thank those that are working on it right now for all their hard efforts. Let's see. I know I owe some council members some follow-up, and over the next week and a half, I will be dealing with a lot of follow-up on some of the requests, because I will not be here for the next meeting. I will be at a conference, and as I try to remind staff and myself that you can take your laptop if you want, but we don't pay for your continuing education to just turn a hotel into a temporary office. So I will do my best to try to get things out to everyone, and if there is things that need to be done before the 19th, please send them to me, and I will do my best to get them done before I leave. But I will be gone for a whole week, so starting the 19th.
Is that it?
That is it, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Item 11 is approval of claims. A is a resolution approving claims. One is the presentation of claims over $25,000. City Manager?
Excuse me. We have $26,376.57 to Albert Lee Convention and Visitors Bureau for lodging tax, $29,841 and you're on page 2.
Oh, it must have been.
There you go.
It wasn't to catch that.
Something was just, yeah, just give me a minute to catch up here, okay?
Go ahead.
Okay, $29,841.22 to Freeborn Mower Electric Cooperative. This is electrical services at water plants and lift stations. $35,988 to Core and Main LP. This is Force Main Materials. $43,675.30 to Tress Incorporated. This is a 2024 GMC Sierra for the Utilities Department. $43,675.30 to Tress Incorporated for a 2024 GMC Sierra. We have for utilities, $43,769.90 to Tress Incorporated for a 2024 GMC Sierra for the Parks Department. $58,354.69 to Larson Contracting Central LLC, payment estimate number one for the 2024 Alley Reconstruction Project, job 2405. $65,673 to Jim and Dude's Plumbing and Heating Incorporated for the City Center Boiler Replacement. $80,370 to Jensen Excavating and Trucking for Force Main Repairs. $154,261.88 to BCM Construction Incorporated, payment estimate two for the 5th and 7th and winter reconstruction project, job 2404. $199,233.64 to Southeast Service Cooperative. This is our health insurance, approximately 87% employer, 13% employee share. $291,689.14 to Wapasha Construction Company Incorporated, payment estimate number three for wastewater treatment plant preliminary facility design and construction. $598,830.40 to Euland Brothers, payment estimate number two for 2024 Neighborhood Improvement Project, job 2401.
Council?
Move to approve the claims, both pages, as read, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Howland. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Seconded by Councilor Anderson. Any further questions? All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 12 is the adjournment.
Motion to adjourn,
Your Honor. Motion by Councilor Howland.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Christian. All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion to adjourn is approved.